I'm particularly excited to be here today, and I would really, really like to thank James and Juliet for putting this together. I'm going to address today philosophical and ethical issues of direct-to-consumer genetic test and mobility. First, I think it's important to say a little bit about the background, because it will explain how I'm getting into this topic. So I think it will also shed some light on both on the scope and limits of the research I'm going to present today. So I've been trained in cognitive science and philosophy, and my area of expertise lays at the crossroad between morality, politics, and science. But I'm really not a specialist in media, and that's very important to say it. I'm unspecialist of media. I've been working these last years among other topics on the human-machine interface, such as brain nanochips and on the ethics of nanotechnologies. And I arrived last year at UCLA for a 2-year project in bioethics. This project aims at relying on the ethics and politics of care to analyze how new biomedical technologies may reshape the concept of patient. So I've been attending staff meetings of the geneticist of UCLA, and I'm currently attending the Children's Hospital Ethical Committee meeting, which are about genetics. In parallel to this research, so this was really supposed to be my research, and in parallel to this, I was puzzled by direct-to-consumer genetic test, which seemed like an odd curiosity when you see it with your French eye. I mean, I knew that this existed, but I did not know that it was so strong in the United States. So it was like something I wanted to toy with, and I realized that it was much more interesting and important than when I thought. So what was a side project is now becoming something very interesting for one reason that you will, I think, very well understand, is that what has been called direct-to-consumer or recreational genetic testing is a lot on the internet. It's always on the internet, so it has been called cybergenetics, and this cybergenetics includes mobility. And I think that this is a great change in the apparatus, guys, and also in our concept of self, of our identity. So what I will present today is really a work in progress that I started just a few months ago, and that was supposed to be really a side project. And I would love to have feedback and even a collaboration if you're interested, because I think there's something to do here. So my plan will be very simple. I will first start to sketch very briefly the landscape of direct-to-consumer genetic testing. And then I would like to wonder with you how we should deal with the mobile DNA that becomes us. Of course, I don't need to stress the reference here, I think. So first, the landscape. So just as a reminder, you probably know that early genetic test is now very easily available in North America, and this is very specific to America. Actually, some polls have shown that the majority of people in the United States say that they intend to take a genetic test. But there are two kinds of genetic tests. One is for medical diagnosis, in the framework of healthcare of medical research, and the second one is recreational or direct-to-consumer genetic diagnosis. And this is the subject of my talk today. So I use very restricted sense of direct-to-consumer. Direct-to-consumer for me refers to a company which receives directly the sample, the biological sample, provides data, and interprets the results, and has its own communication, at least a website. So this is different from a lot of companies which do not receive or analyze the samples. So here are the other categories. And what is important is that recently mobility has become a very important property of direct-to-consumer medical testing. And to me, as a bioethicist, and I will not have the time to stress this here, but it's very important to distinguish this DTC mobility from mobile health. So when we started mapping the DTC market last quarter, we limited the study to the DTC companies in the restricted sense I just gave you to the US market, and we found, all in all, around 200 companies. which is a lot because the definition was so restrictive. It's much more, actually, than what was in the papers we were reading before. And also, we were really surprised that the type of results were so diverse. There is results of ancestry, health, but in a very broad sense, including diet, nutrition, and also fitness, relatedness tests, immigration tests, paternity tests, cheating tests, but also tests about wine, matchmaking, talents, and especially child talents, which seem to be very important in China, for instance. And also there are some tests which would tell you which kind of superhero genes you may have. So that's very, very diverse. There are a lot of philosophical issues with the DTC. I want to stress them because I think that these properties are also present in mobile DTC. First, I'm relying on the politics of care to try to show that there is a relational responsibility involved, because people give up their genetic samples, not only the data, and they also give up indirectly their related data. And this has been shown recently by FBI inquiries, which, for instance, asked 23andMe to give the data from relatives of people who are guilty of murder. Second point, there is no privacy. Privacy is also an issue. And this is very interesting, because in the privacy statement of 23andMe, they say, if you have any concern about privacy, just don't take the test. That's beautiful. There is also an issue about discrimination and insurances, even if the American law is supposed to deal with this. And I would like to stress that this is definitely a new gold rush, not only about data mining, but also we don't really know what is happening with samples. As I told previously, the market of cyber genetics mobility is developing very fast. The most important DTC companies have apps, be it directly or not. It's interesting to note that these apps have been developed for every kind of result. Of course, there are also apps that require the customer to upload their genetic data, but these are not part of my study. So here are some examples of the mobile apps you can find. So you see that they are really interest any kind of results which goes from ancestry to matchmaking. Let's take a closer look at a matchmaking app, Pheromone. Have you ever wondered what's behind the connection? I guess that Marcel Proust would have been very interested in this, or maybe not. So just, I would like to give you some quotes from their FAQ, which seem to me very interesting. Pheromone uses both your biology and your social technology. We collect your genetic data and acquire your likes, dislikes, and interests from your social media profiles like Facebook, Twitter, etc. The more you use Pheromone, the more the dating app learns what types of profiles you prefer, and the better it can recommend the most compatible singles for you. Use our app and know if sparks are there before you invest your time in a first date. It brings the human aspect of dating to the palm of your hand. And of course, we take the privacy and security of your genetic information very seriously. No one will ever see your genetic data, not even you, which seemed to me pretty scary. So the question is, how should we deal with the mobile DNA that becomes? I would like now to focus on the philosophical analysis of this phenomenon. So first, it's important to stress that these apps reinforce certain properties of DTC, as the feeling that there is no mediation or that there is a perfect personalization. And this is one reason why the landscape of DTC was a necessary preliminary. But these apps also introduce new properties into cybergenetics. They are omnipresent and intimate. They are more than a best friend forever, like a guardian angel. And I think that this links to the first talk, actually. I don't have the time, maybe we can come to this in the discussion. So here are my working hypothesis. I suggest that these apps stand at the crossroad between the biological and the social. They wear genetic identity with algorithmic identity, and they give birth to a new kind of determinism. This new determinism is a hybrid between what is considered as genetic determinism and the patterns of life determinism that are made up by algorithms. It's important to stress here that these apps should not be confused with any kind of mobile health and that they are seeping in every aspect of our life. Slowly they may become trivial and settle a new kind of ordinarity. Last but not least, I think they're able to modify deeply our intimate as well as social set. To explore this working hypothesis, I think that three perspectives may be of help. They are different, but I think they are complementary and converging. So I'm not yet completely sure as how they should be interwoven, but we may discuss this later. The first perspective aims at distinguishing, on the one hand, an individual in connection, and on the other hand, an individual in relationships. The second one is the new panopticon, and the last but not least one is the apparatgeist. So if I may rewind up a bit the story, as I said in the introduction, I came to UCLA to work on the hypothesis that certain new biomedical technologies are changing completely our concept of patient. Working among others on genetics, I proposed the hypothesis that we should distinguish between a patient in relationship and a patient in connection or in network. Here you can read the main characteristic of the patient in relationship. He is in relationships with groups of different, a lot of different persons, groups of things. These relationships are interwoven and complex, often asymmetrical, but most importantly, for our purpose today, they differ from data and networks, even if they sometimes go along with data in networks. So that's very important to me. I'm not trying to introduce a new binarity here, I'm either or. I'm trying to show that these two categories are different and to understand how they could or not work together. So here is now the patient in connection or in network. There are many examples of the patient in network and many kinds of networks, of course. Here, it's important to note that when the patient is in a network, he's a client in the ancient meaning of the word. Why am I bringing this up? First, because I think that the relationship between the patient in connection and the patient in network is asymmetrical. We can promote the network without giving up the relationships. But I'm not sure that we can be limited to the networks without losing the relationships. Second and foremost, I think that this may become an issue in a democratic society and that the framework can be enlarged between the patient toward an individual in connection and an individual in relationship. So bioethics was just my starting point and I think there's something broader here. Second, the individual in connection is even more troubling when it's considered along with what I would like to call the new panopticon. So as you may remember, the old panopticon is a circular tower so as to be able to monitor the inmates at all times. You see the schema on the screen. More recently, some researchers have coined the expression genetic panopticon to refer to a system of management which aims to control individual behavior through the use of their genetic data, whether or not in a criminal context. And what I would like to suggest is that actually we now have a new panopticon which is both mobile and genetic. We carry it with us, it links what is inside our DNA and what is outside at all times. So maybe we could say that we are now the inmates of our mobile prosthesis, and even more interesting, I think, to say that we don't know which data are sent to the DTC companies, and we don't know how they are analyzed to be sent back to us. And remember what was written in Ferramore, FAQ. You don't even have access to your own data. And I think that's very important. There is some kind of black box here. I think that last, and not least, the apparatgeist allows us to go one step further and understand more completely the properties of DTC mobile apps. This mobile genetics entails that we are in perpetual contact with our DNA, which may seem a bit obvious, of course, because our DNA is inside us, so we carry it with us at all times. But what is less obvious is that these apps are seeping in any aspect of our social routines. I've already shown that, but I would like to repeat it now. They appear as objective, as impartial, as if science was in the palm of your own hand. But this, I think this may be less a democratization of science than a new sacralization of technology. As if new oracles, we were speaking about the angels just before, but I think now it is as if oracles were to speak directly to one's ear, and I find this pretty interesting too. So just a few conclusions and perspectives. I think that these DTC apps may appear as a second nature. They can become intertwined in the texture of the consumer's life at all time and in all matters. They are an apparat. But I would like to suggest something else for the apparatgeist theory today. I think they are also an appareil in the French culinary meaning. I don't know if you know this, but I would like to have my French moment now. Actually, the French appareil, this is the mixture when you are cooking, when all the ingredients are combined, and just before it takes its final shape through a transformation process, for instance, when you would cook it, put it in the pan. So it's when you have all the ingredients together, you have mixed them, and you have to take the next step. So I think maybe this could be something else from German to French, because it feels to me that this is also in the apparatgeist. And I think also that, returning now to the DTC apps, trusting their objectivity and impartiality may change the consumer's sense of self as being a very predetermined self in the two aspects I've been speaking of today. And this is all the most interesting because, of course, these apps could be designed to orient or even shape the consumer's, the client, as I said before, lives. So, last but not least, I think there is probably much more to analyze than that. I just started, as I said, to work on these apps with a group of students and a colleague, but who is a lawyer actually, but we have a lot of methodological issues, and here are some of them, and I would love to have some input on this maybe later. Especially because we cannot get into the apps, and I don't want the students to get into the apps and to give any data or to give any biological sample. So how are you doing, guys, in media studies to get into these apps as an outsider? I guess you have some strategies here. And also, how can we learn about the companies that are dead since the websites have been taken down? And, well, how can we learn about the business side of these companies? What we've seen is only a part of it, and we just don't know how to search it, because, as I said, I'm a philosopher. I can work about brain technology, for instance, but I don't know how to work about media. So a lot of help is needed to work on these apps, and I would love to do this with you. And last but not least, I would like to thank my collaborator, Carol Scott, who is studying the legal aspects of this field, and also all the students, and especially Kate Plendenen, who sent me her picture here, who have been really very helpful in this. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Vanessa, for that wonderful talk.
It's the first time I present this, so I know I took all the pieces of the puzzle here and tried to combine them.
I was curious how third-party interpretation services, where people take the information they've got into like 23andMe and give it to a different company. So they take the information they've already gotten, take the raw data, and kind of distribute it again, might fit into your schema there.
So I haven't been working on this because I kept this aside, but from what I've seen, actually it's not the raw data, they don't get the raw data, and this is an important point too. The way you are framing the analysis is very meaningful too, but this is exactly what I've kept in the dark, And I've done it on purpose because what really puzzles me here, what puzzled me here at the beginning was the samples issue. So that's the reason why I chose such a restrictive definition of DTC companies. And actually, there were so many of them that we were surprised, because when I started to make this state of the art, the definition of the papers was much less restrictive, and they had about 200 companies too. So that's why we had to start from scratch, which was bad, because I'm not a sociologist, I'm not a specialist of this, but I felt like for scientific reasons I had to do it again, which is a lot for the students. Sometimes you have, you know, you think you can rely on the data and the papers of your colleagues, and actually you realize that no, there's a problem here. You have to do it from scratch.
Thank you very much. I admire your courage in going out beyond your comfort zone to have very bold ideas, very provocative ideas, very rich ideas. If I may, some of our students actually did research on DTC with some of the students who were part of that project, like to share with us.
Yeah, well, that was, Blake and I worked on that, but we sort of worked on the inverse of what you're talking about. We actually focused on the third-party interpretation services as opposed to the companies that were doing the testing of the samples, I think precisely because we thought that they were
shady.
Yeah, there were less regulatory pressures upon them, and so it was a little bit more of a Wild West situation. But we encountered a lot of the same sort of methodological issues, and that ended up being our focus, was trying to identify all of the different companies that were out there and had been out there, and which ones were being used. And we relied a lot on analyzing people's social media discourses to figure out what they were talking about as a way of deducing what they were using and what information they were actually sharing with the companies and how they felt about that. And something that we found that was interesting and perhaps disturbing within your framework was the overwhelmingly positive response of most of the customers, that most people seemed quite happy about sharing that much information.
Yeah, that was my starting point, actually. My starting point when I knew about this, because I had been working with nanoscientists who are designing some genetic tests. I had been doing this in France. And when they went up to the commercial level, they were very, we discussed the ethics of this a lot, and they were really very careful not to sell it to companies who would like to put this in supermarkets. And that was really an issue that we discussed together for months. And then I arrived here, and you know, when I was speaking about 23andMe, it was like a joke at the end of the talk. And so this was part of my comfort zone. And then I arrived here, and what surprised me is that people were so comfortable with that, and also that they felt like they were having a good deal to pay for such a little money and to give such priceless, not only data but samples, and not only their own but their families. So this was really, to me, a paradox with my French eye again, but I think that's why such this kind of workshops and meetings are really interesting. And this was exactly my starting point. But I didn't look at this on the social medias, just, you know, talking with people. And actually my lab is at the Institute for Society and Genetics, so I realized that a lot of students had been not compelled, but, you know, encouraged to take this kind of test for as part of their classes. And to me it was like, I wouldn't dare to say crazy here, but a little bit. So this was like real life, you know, I got into this, and it was, wow, what's going on here? And I think that what you said about sharing is very important here. Because in France, we are not encouraged to share that much. At school, I have 5 years of kids, and I was surprised that they were always asked to share. And also, it's not only about privacy, it's about what people would, it's a short social issue, what people would think that you should do. So it's some kind of social pressure. And I think this has a lot to do with Facebook too, the idea of sharing on Facebook. So all this seemed linked and convergent to me, but I didn't know what to do with that. So that's why I started to work on it, because I was present. But it was from real life, not from the social media. I don't have a Facebook account, so I'm really, you know, weird.
Well, I don't know if it's going to be relevant, but when you ask about methodology, how one can enter the issue, especially since there are a lot of ethical issues here. Actually, we are conducting a research in the University of Lorraine with Belgium and Switzerland in order to understand Facebook's algorithm, which is all right. But the thing is, we have asked our students to create false profiles that are predefined and that they can have special behaviors that we predefined. And I was thinking that it could be some kind of entry, perhaps, to work on the social profile issues without having to show your real personality. Of course, genetics is another
issue. Yeah, this is a problem. To use these apps, you are required to send the sample.
Yeah.
Okay? So that's...
I perfectly understand that.
That's the problem.
Yeah.
And we know since 2012, more or less, that even if people say that they anonymize the samples, actually, DNA is what is, it is an identification itself. So it's something that cannot be anonymized, contrary to what the DTC companies or the doctors would say. And so that's really a methodological problem when engaging into this kind of studies. Because this kind of strategy is exactly what we can't do. And I think this in itself is very interesting, because here we are, you know, pointing at something which is in nature different.
Yeah.
It's combining both, but there is something, we are getting to a new step. And this is why my appareil, you know, everything is mixed and we don't know how it will be cooked. Sorry for my French cooking. But I mean, here there's really something which we need to address from a political and ethical point of view. I think it's really pressing to do it, so I feel like there is an emergency. Here, that's why also I started to look at this more seriously. But how, this is exactly what we can do, you see?
Yes,
so perfect.
It's fascinating to me, I'm overwhelmed with the ambition. It's a beautiful series of things. No, really very philosophically interesting. So the dialectic between voluntary and not voluntary, determinism and not determinism. I mean, I wonder in the United States, with ancestors, ancestry and then dating apps. Now, in the case of ancestry, it seems to me part of what's going on is something specific to the United States, which is the racial history of the United States. I mean, my family's from the South, and people are starting to get on Ancestry, and we have some Cherokee ancestors. That feels good. We know some other bad ones. So there's kind of, actually, people are doing history through doing genetics in ways that matter to them, and why it matters to them is that's the next step, of course, because then we have this whole idea of determinism, you call it. But, you know, why should it matter if I mean, it's nice that I had a Cherokee great-grandmother, it makes me feel a little better, but people have this sort of idea of determinism, so I think this is a philosophically very fascinating thing. And I wonder if it's universal in the Operatgeist that people tend to think, you know, I'm overwhelmed with data, I'm overwhelmed with stories. If I offload it to a machine, I can get some relief.
Yeah.
And I can do that with dating, and I was part of the Operatgeist that we were all saturated. And so on the one hand, it's very private and very personal, and one does worry about insurance companies using the internet. On the other hand, it's so overwhelming that people are now just sort of giving up. And the other very observant thing you said was about sharing in American culture. I think this is also perhaps something symptomatic of a very large empire that always had trouble keeping itself together. And just an anecdote from when I lived in Berlin with my daughter. We were having a little bake sale to raise money for the children. And it was at the John F. Kennedy School, which is an American-German, half Americans, half Germans. So the American parents all felt that we should allow volunteer payments. You would pay as much as you liked for the brownie. And they were convinced that we would make much more money doing that, because in the United States, that's what you do. You volunteer. You don't put price tags on the brownies at the school. The German mothers were outraged. They said, this is ridiculous. You have to tag everything that has any and a complete cultural breakdown. I think you're very observant about this whole the insistence on sharing in the United States in a kind of perhaps more Darwinian Wild West context is very interesting part of the operation.
So, if I may just follow up these two remarks. The first one is when I remember when I was like overrun with this issue of ancestry, I was in New York in the subway reading on my mobile phone one of your emails, actually. And I just, you know, had a look and there was an ad about one of these DTC companies, and actually, contrary to what I would have thought, because I have a colleague at UCLA who worked on the white supremacist genetic ancestry test and the way they were dealing with this on the social medias. So I thought this was a white issue, and actually, there was an ad of a woman who was brownish, kind of black. And actually, this is and there was I took a picture also with my mobile phone of this, but there was something written like I have a 5% of Irish in my blood, and then I realized, wow, this is so shocking to me, and also I just came over from a newspaper of the Jewish community here with a lot of ads about this, and I was very shocked because in France, if you it would be like, you know, going to the Gestapo to say that you are Jewish. So to me, this was like amazing, and I started understanding that this was very American, very racial, but not as I thought a white people thing. And then I started reading about this, and actually there are a lot of stories about how not only the personal narratives are modified by this test, but also how the collective narratives are modified among, for instance, some Indians who had a history about how they came to their valley, and then thanks to genetic tests they didn't ask for, they realized that it was not the case. And a few years ago there was also a paper in the New York Times about another case of a collective narrative which was modified by this. And I think this is really constitutive of our identity, but this is the genetic part. My point is that now we are at the crossroad of the biological and the social. Yes. And I didn't have a nice schema to show this because it's not completely clear in my hand, so this was my problem with making a PowerPoint. But I would need your help here. But I think this crossroad is now something very, very, very special. And that's why I kept on working on this, because, you know, I have really more important things to do, but I had other things to do. And I realized here there is something, and we need to join our forces. And that's why I was so excited to come here. I mean, truly, not only because I'm polite, I'm not very polite, but I think there's something we need to work together, philosopher, media scientists, and probably biologists too, because I don't think that genetics is as determinist as people think.
Yes.
Thank you, Vanessa, for this wonderful talk. I just had a question going back to the idea of privacy erosion.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned that, you know, Facebook might be responsible for this willingness to expose yourself. But I was wondering if it could be useful to link this argument to the nothing to hide argument.
Exactly.
And the fact that, you know, state surveillance programs sort of also shifted mm-hmm. our understanding of what is exactly privacy mm-hmm. and how we should relate to mm-hmm. our own self. So I don't know what you can, you know.
That's exactly the answer. I asked a geneticist about this, like, because actually it's, for us this is very confusing. I'm speaking to the persons from the consulate here, because we have this public health system in France, and so when, you know, the hospitals have genetic data, they are supposed to take care of them. Here in the States, it's more complicated, and actually the hospitals send the samples to private, the hospitals are often private, and they send the samples to private labs who keep them. And actually, so I was discussing this with some geneticists because we are working on this deontology code for the Children's Hospital of Los Angeles. I'm just a guest at the ethics committee, but that was just the right time to be there by chance. You know, research is by chance. I'm talking to the students here. That's like you have, you know, you have the right moment and you have to seize it. And so I discussed this with the geneticist, like, you know, you're not even discussing the fact that you are giving away your patient samples and data, and he said, but we have nothing to hide. And this is very Protestant to me too, this idea that the curtains have to be wide open. And that if you don't want to give something, if you don't want to have a Facebook account, for instance, it means that you have something to hide.
Yeah. And you become suspicious.
The point is that now it's not only you, it's your family too. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
You see your relatives, even your non-born kids. Or nephews are, you know.
Just a quick comment. Have you seen the work done where they can take the genetic code if it's fully mapped out, and if you have the input, it draws a picture of the person's face?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've seen that.
So with the police survey, you know, how to identify these criminals or not, I mean, that's the open interest in terms of the development.
I think that, but what I've heard in the staff meetings of the geneticists at UCLA last year was a lot of discussion actually about genetics, and I had the feeling that it was not as deterministic as people would think, because we know only a little bit, not so many mutations, and you can have, you know, other mutations that we don't know, which could just block the consequences of the first mutation. So it's so much more complicated, and it's such a young science that actually I think the idea of the deterministic genetics is completely to be discussed, to be polite.
I think it was making a slightly different point, but I do agree with what you're saying.
Just one, I don't want to have the conversation. So I think there are two issues you've raised that have come up in several of our NOAA events through the year. They're dealing with radically different topics, but I thought I would just, as long as we're being philosophers, we organize problems. So one of them is the problem of archiving.
Mm-hmm.
The problem of the data being available, of course, it not only connects you with your relatives, but it does it through all of your unborn people for whom you will be ancestor. So potentially it's the time scale, and I think this is something in Abgeordtgeist that you do talked about in the introduction. But it's the time scale, it's the cultivating of these enormous data sets over time, and we have no idea how valuable any of this information really will be or is ahead of time. And that's a theme that's come up with, for example, we had someone talking, verifying videos coming out of Syria. Well, in Europe, after an hour, if it's a very violent video, YouTube has to take it down. But that could be, you know, evidence that someone has risked their life to get. And what happens to those YouTube videos that are taken down? How do you preserve all of that? So that's one thing. The other thing is that I think this issue of privacy comes up all over the place. So people talk now about smart cities, for example. The city of Boston is giving away a lot of our data for free. There are wonderful apps. For example, you put it on a car, it'll measure if there's a pothole, people can go fix the pothole. But in fact, there's this terrible situation in a sense in which the universities used to have the data and the knowledge. Now the data is in the hands of private companies. And so there is a real larger question, I think, about institutions in
Abgeordtgeist.
And how we build them. They're political issues, they're also knowledge issues, and I think they go to the role of the university, what we do with our undergraduate students. I wanted to ask you what you'd have to do. So these are very big issues, not illustrated so beautifully by your talk.
Thank you very much. Just if I can come back to your first point, I think that the issue is about archiving, but it's not only about time scales, it's also about relationships. And I would like to stress this because this is what I got from the ethics and politics of care. that if we think only about time scale, we think about, you know, a network and a media. And there is something more. So I don't mean to say we shouldn't think in this way. You see, I'm not a binary thinker. And this is also what I offer to the ethics of care. I'm trying to articulate this. But we have to go deeper. I mean, this time scale has also texture, as you, I love this, the way you put this in your books and in articles, but it's all about relationships. Mm-hmm. And so it's not only an issue of time scales, it's an issue of relationships and different kind of relationships. So this comes into, you know, some kind of texture and relief. How would we say it in English? It's like it was flat. Mm-hmm. And then it comes to different, you see it in different
dimensions.
Yeah, dimensions, but not only dimensions, but yet it's something
science. Different. Like science?
Science, yeah.
Science.
And you know, when you can touch it, then, because it's, so, it's all this.
So, just a couple quick things. So, it's interesting in your talk, it's all about information. Genetics is transmission of information, the media and communication stuff. Transition of information and how those are intersecting. I also wonder about when we think about the lab brackets, whatever, and all that, is the it's fundamentally disruptive nature that's going on. And I think you have to, and you were kind of pushing at this, is what's getting disrupted here, right? And with this, is that do we really, I mean, I think most people think, really think that the social construct of their ethnicity and their race is bound up in their gene.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like, come on.
Yeah.
It doesn't work that way. But that's what's getting disrupted. Right? How do we, you know, what's going on around that? And if that way we think of each other and how we connect changes the social dimension, right, to match or deal with each other in the world, that could be quite a large upheaval.
I think that's an agreeable question to you, or if you have something to say. No, completely, but I would even go further. I think that this is trying to make us predictable, and what we are is not predictable, so it's as if we would become not only machines, you know, but biological machines, so to speak, and we are something more than that, because we are surprising. And also, if we have, this is what we call forms of life, as opposed to patterns of life.
Right.
And I think that's something I didn't want to bring here, because it would be like putting another philosophical concept. That's also why the concept of forms of life, which I've been lucky to work on thanks to Somha, because I didn't know it before, seems to me very appealing, as opposed to patterns of life. So I think that's what we should.
Well, thank you. On that note, since I will talk about forms of life later.
And if you have, you know, just suggestions, methodological or others, I would take it. It all is yours.
Vanessa, thank you very much.